So, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I would like to welcome you to the Amram Scholar Series tonight. Our lecture this evening is provided for us by the Leo and Elizabeth Goodman Public Issues Endowment, and we're very thankful for that, and this is an incredibly appropriate book and lecture. I told this to our guest tonight, Roberta Kaplan, who is here. I mentioned that I was a little upset with her.
It's not the first time I've heard that, Rabbi.
And the reason I was upset is I really wanted to skim her book, which is an impossibility. The book is incredibly captivating. And it is, I have to admit, you know, having lived in the same house with a lawyer for 30 years, I was not exactly excited sitting down as a rabbi to read a book about a court case. But our tradition says, tzedek, tzedek, tirdof, the justice, justice you should pursue. Then Comes Marriage is a book about just that, the pursuit of justice, but it is also about human dignity, equality, and reminding us what really, really matters in life. It is a story of the heart, about people wanting to feel whole, accepted, and about the power of love, God's love given to us as a gift. This is not a lawyer's book. It's not a lawyer's book about a case. This is a Jewish book about being called to do justly, to stand up for what is right. In touching prose, Roberta Kaplan, Robbie tells a story that leads to a court case, not a case that has a story. She reminds us that marriage equality, about our, each of us, accepting equality and what we're willing to fight for. It is a beautiful book about heroes, people who cared enough to act, who fought battles because deep inside they know we are each created in God's image, no matter who or how we love. I am proud that Robbie Kaplan is gay, that she believes in justice, that she is a great litigator, and that all those things in her case make her Jewish. I know you will be touched as well. For Edie Windsor, honored Thea Spire's love by making America do what is right. I could read you all the incredible things about this woman as a litigator, what she has done, and how fast she has risen through the ranks. But I think what will speak most is letting her tell this touching story, because it goes to the heart of what social justice is about. It goes to the heart, actually, in my mind, about what America is facing now in its political battles. And I'm very honored and very pleased, and I want to thank Leslie Maitland, who, it was kind of strange to me because Leslie Maitland is always coming to me and saying she picks our speakers. She's always coming saying that, you know, it's got to be Jewish. And I looked at the book and I said, come on. But this is one of the most Jewish books that we've had all year long, because it's about the heart of justice. And to me, that is very Jewish. So I'm honored that Roberta Kaplan will join us here this evening to present her presentation of Then Comes Marriage. Ladies and gentlemen, Roberta Kaplan.
Thank you for having me. I'm going to begin by talking a little bit. I'm going to kind of mix the Jewish and the SCOTUS stuff in the same thing. Seem like the right topics to cover tonight. So I'm going to start with an explanation of what I think an explanation of why United States v. Windsor is such a Jewish case. And of course, we have a First Amendment, and there's separation between church and state in our country, and there should be. But there are aspects of United States v. Windsor that are very, very Jewish. So the first aspect, I think, is that many people believe, including my rabbi in New York, Rabbi Jan Erbach, that one way of looking at Judaism is seeing Judaism as kind of a philosophy about the passage of time. And that what Judaism does is it helps us organize time and helps us organize our lives through the passage of time. So every year in Judaism, as we all know, we go through the same cycle. We celebrate the same festivals at the same time. And hopefully every year we're a little bit different. We've changed a little bit as we kind of go through the circle again and again and again. And because of that very essential aspect of Judaism, and because many, if not most, of the people involved in the United States v. Windsor happen to be Jewish, that festival cycle actually had a big impact on the case. So I'll give you a couple of examples. So the first and probably most prominent was the argument. So we filed the case, and then we had an appeal in the Second Circuit Court of Appeals. And Edie at that point in time was not in good health, and I was very anxious to make sure that the case was resolved while she was still healthy, not only alive, but healthy enough to enjoy it. She's, by the way, totally fine today, 86, has more energy on many days than I do. But back at that point, I was very concerned. And so we asked the Second Circuit for a very expedited schedule, which they gave us. And we got the briefing date from the Second Circuit. We got an order with the briefing date, and the date had been set for the day after Yom Kippur. I wasn't too thrilled about that. I thought to myself and discussed with my team, no problem. We'll get this changed. The first thought actually in my head, all I could think of, was Sandy Koufax. In my generation, I grew up in Cleveland. One of my friends, one of my closest friends from growing up, is sitting in the second row there. And growing up in Cleveland at that point in time was very much like growing up on the Upper West Side of New York, frankly. Most of the people I knew were Jewish. I lived in a very Jewish community. And growing up, in my family at least, especially for the men in my family, Sandy Koufax was the all-time hero. So I kind of grown up with this legend. I get the decision from the Second Circuit that says the argument's the day after Yom Kippur, and I'm like, oh my God, we have to do something about this because I'm not working. I can't work the day before the argument. So we wrote a letter to the Second Circuit saying, can you please reschedule the argument? And we got an answer back very shortly saying no. Well, it turns out I now know why that was. It was because the then chief judge of the Second Circuit, Dennis Jacobs, was hearing cases on that day, and he wanted to hear this case. He had the prerogative to do that as the chief judge, and so he insisted that it be on that day. That ended up being a very good thing. But at the time, I wasn't too happy about it. So I spent the day before the Second Circuit argument, Paul Clement arguing on the other side. I don't think he spent that day doing the same thing I did. I spent that day at Yom Kippur services with Edie Windsor. In retrospect, I think it was probably the best thing I could have done to prepare for the argument because I was so kind of prepared at that point. I'm not sure it would have made that much of a difference. I have to admit, though, that the minute it was sundown and I managed to kind of snarf down a bagel and lox, I went immediately to my office and started reading cases again for the next day. Another thing that happened on the cycle, kind of the Jewish cycle of festivals, was March 27th, 2013, which was actually the three-year anniversary was this last Saturday. It was the third or fourth day of Passover. I think it was the third day of Passover that year. And we were all, I'd been in D.C. already at that point for about 2 weeks, kind of living here and preparing for the argument. And we were all going to be in D.C. and we had to deal with the Seder. So we ended up having about 60 people in a conference room. I don't say this in the book, but I can say it now, at the Mandarin Oriental Hotel. My entire family, my wife's entire family, Edie and her friends, my dear friend Pam Carlin and her spouse, and everyone who was working on the cases and all their friends in a conference room during the Seder. I have to admit that I was not exactly kind of zen and mellow that night. I was still pretty hyped up. But no one who was sitting in that room, I think, was not incredibly aware of kind of how momentous that Seder was, about what was going to happen the next day, which was the Perry argument, as I recall, and the day after, which was my argument. It was one of the most miraculous seders of my life, and it's something I will never, ever forget. Ironically, I hadn't been that involved in the details because I was kind of obsessing about reading Supreme Court cases 24 hours a day. But my wife arranged everything, and one of the things she had to insist on was that when they had the matzo ball soup, that they not put any wontons in it. Another way that I think the Windsor case is very, very Jewish has to do with the ultimate decision in the case. In his decision, Justice Kennedy uses this word, and you actually heard the rabbi refer to the same concept, dignity, something like 12 times in 11 pages of the majority opinion. When he says that word over and over and over again, what Justice Kennedy means is that gay people have the same dignity as everyone else. In fact, in the Obergefell decision exactly 2 years later, he uses the phrase equal dignity, making it clear that that's what he meant. I've never spoken to Justice Kennedy about this. I'm not sure that I ever will. But I strongly believe that Justice Kennedy's view of the equal dignity of all people, including LGBT people, is very much informed by this a view similar to what all Jewish people have, which is that every single human being was created in the divine image. And that if we were all created in the divine image, then we all have to have the same essential dignity. And even, as I said before, the Constitution recognizes a separation between church and state, that moral understanding, which is a word I used at the Supreme Court, that moral understanding that gay people have the same dignity as everyone else is something that truly animates the revolutionary nature of his decision in Windsor, which led to Obergefell and led to this incredibly different world that we live in today. So let me try to kind of give you guys a little bit of background about the case and about my wonderful client, Edie Windsor, another Jewish woman. And then I'm going to try to ultimately bring you into the Supreme Court courtroom exactly 3 years ago Saturday to the arguments. This is kind of the law geeks version of ESPN Sports Night. They don't allow filming, as I'm sure you all know, inside the Supreme Court courtroom, but they do have audio tape. So we've kind of taken the greatest hits from the argument, and I will tell you what I was thinking. I'll try to tell you what I was thinking. I'll kind of comment on what I think was going on. And then at the end, of course, you can ask me questions. So my client, Edie Windsor, now 86, has truly become a phenomenon. She lives just a few blocks away from me in Greenwich Village, and it's literally the case that she cannot leave her apartment without being kind of, approached, mobbed sometimes by people who want her photograph, who want her autograph, who want selfies with her. Fortunately for Edie, that's not a bad thing. Edie likes it. She likes the attention. And part of, I think it's not a coincidence that Edie's become such a phenomenon. We very much, as a strategy, built our case around her and her story. So part of that is a wonderful article that Ariel Levy, my friend Ariel Levy, wrote in The New Yorker about the case. I cannot read the first sentence of the article out loud to anyone in this room. You can read it for yourselves, or I'll tell you later. But it's a very accurate kind of depiction of the way things were on the case and kind of the relationship between Edie and myself and the rest of our team. In 2013, Edie was actually up for Time Magazine Person of the Year. She didn't quite succeed. She came in as runner-up. The Time Magazine Person of the Year was the Pope. Edie has told me that she was totally okay with that. She understood the decision. But again, it gives you the kind of sense of the degree to which she has become really an icon, I think not only in the gay community, but frankly in American, in all of America, and certainly in terms of American history. Moving from the sublime to the ridiculous, if you had ever told me when I was growing up in Cleveland that one day I would grow up, that I would be an out lesbian, that I would get married to a woman, that we would have a kid, in a Jewish ceremony, by the way, that we would have a kid, that I would be a partner to a firm like Paul Weiss, that I would win a pretty big deal Supreme Court case, and that I would be on the pages of Cosmo magazine, I'm pretty sure that I would have told you that you were, and I'm going to date myself, that you were going to far too many Grateful Dead concerts, and that you really needed to cut it out. I think one of the reasons why that Edie has become the huge phenomenon that she is really has to do with her story. So let me tell you a bit, looking at the clock, but let me tell you a bit about her story and why I think it's so compelling, and then we'll get into the Supreme Court. Edie grew up in the West Side, West Philly, West Side of Philadelphia. Her father lost his business, and they lost their home during the Depression. He had a business distributing candy in Philadelphia. They moved in with relatives. She went to Temple University, and while she was at Temple University, she actually fell in love with a woman for the very first time and realized that she was a lesbian. But in her view, and her thinking at the time, and this you kind of have to go back, I don't know if people have seen the movie Carol, but this is kind of the period of Carol. In her view, the idea of living your life as a queer, her word, was impossible. And so things didn't work out with that woman. She graduated from Temple, and she ended up marrying a guy by the name of Windsor. That's how she gets the name, Saul Windsor. Saul Windsor was her brother's best friend. They had kind of grown up together. It turns out that they graduated college together because Saul and Edie's brother both went and fought in the Army in World War II, and then they graduated and they got to go to college. I mean, after the war, they got to go to college on the GI Bill. And even though Saul was older than Edie, they graduated college at the same time, and he was kind of nudging her, to get married, and after college, she finally agreed. Needless to say, that marriage didn't last very long. It lasted only a matter of months. After a matter of months, Edie basically, she said she would walk, they would go out on Saturday evenings with her husband, and she would see two women together, and she would get jealous. And she finally realized she had to tell her husband the truth, so she essentially came out to her husband, this is the 50s, early 50s, and she said to him that he deserved to be loved truly the way he deserved to be loved, and that she needed something else. Kind of a sequel to that story, Edie was very worried. We told this story in the case, and I'll explain why. But Edie was very worried after the case had become such a sensation that Saul Windsor had not told his, ended up getting married again and went on to have a family, and that maybe he hadn't told his second wife and his family about this. And it was kind of some stress at the case because she wanted us to kind of get rid of all the affidavits that had been publicly filed about it. And I said, Edie, we can't do that. And she was very worried about it after the decision. And one day she was in New York in her apartment about to go out and the phone rang. And she kind of ran back in to get the phone, and it turns out that on the phone was Saul Windsor's wife, that she was very, very aware of who Edie was, that he'd always told his family about Edie. That had, I think more than anything else in the case, that fact has made Edie an incredibly happy person. They've remained friends, and I now have full permission to tell the story about Edie and Saul Windsor, so I'm telling it now. Now, it's a great story. But you might think to yourself, well, why is it? It's not only kind of a great story, but it's legally a great story. And so why is it legally a great story? Well, shortly into the case, just as we kind of were starting discovery, we got a call from the lawyers on the other side saying that they wanted us to produce to them a copy of Edie Windsor's marriage certificate to Saul Windsor. At first I was worried because I was like, I'm not sure we can get that. It turns out Edie had already had it because when she got married to Thea many years later, she needed it and she already had it. And we kind of listened, I played it straight, no pun intended, on the phone. And I said, we would see what we could do. And we hung up the phone and I and the three or four colleagues in my office all kind of started doing, you guys remember the church lady from Saturday Night Live? We all started kind of doing the church lady dance in my office. Why? Because we knew that the reason that the other side wanted evidence of Edie's first marriage was to show that Edie somehow had a choice about being gay. One of the main arguments that was used, particularly back at this point in time, to argue why it's okay to discriminate against gay people was to argue that, you know, we're not really sure who's gay, you know, gay one day, not gay the next day, lesbians at Smith, I can say that because my wife went there, you know, you never really know. And because people can switch or have a choice about being gay, then it's okay to treat them differently because they can choose. That's the argument. We knew that they were going to use evidence of Edie's marriage to Saul Windsor's to show that, and we were thrilled because we knew that Edie's marriage to Saul Windsor proved exactly the opposite, right? It was the early 50s. Excuse me, I have a scratch in my throat. If Edie had had a choice about being gay, then she'd still be married to Saul Windsor. She'd be living on the main line, probably in Philadelphia today, and we never would have had the case. The fact is she didn't have a choice, and that's why she took the incredibly brave step that she did, which was to come out to her husband in the 50s and then to move to New York, like myself and so many others, in order to be gay. So she moves to New York. The biggest issue in New York, frankly, was not being gay. Because back then, anyone who was gay, unless you were willing to live really at the margins of society or were in the arts somehow, you had to be in the closet. It was just completely impossible to live your life any other way. So that being gay was not really the issue. The bigger issue, frankly, for Edie was being a woman. Because I'm sure you have all seen pictures of Edie. She's a beautiful woman today. She was a beautiful, stunning woman back then. She'd always grown up thinking she'd get married and then her husband would support her. And now, all of a sudden, she needs to figure out how she's going to support herself. It turns out that she had been good at math, believe it or not, in high school. So she decided to enter the mathematics master's program at NYU, which she did. And she became one of the first people ever, frankly, to be a software programmer. She earned her way, kind of paid her way through grad school by getting a job writing code for what I understand was then the biggest computer in the world. It was called the UNIVAC computer. It took up an entire city block at NYU. It was used for the Atomic Energy Commission. And that's what she did. She said that when you wrote the code back then, it was like writing code on toilet paper. That's the way it looked. And she once had a boss who said to her that she could fix any bug known to mankind as long as she had a roll of toilet paper. She could fix it. So she's working at this job. She gets a letter one day. She was living on the Upper West Side. And she gets a letter from the FBI. This is the McCarthy period now. And the letter says, we want you to come in to talk to us about your Q, believe it or not, your Q security clearance. We don't think you need a lawyer yet, but we'd like you to come in and talk to us. So Edie actually did some research on her own, and she determined, which turns out it was correct, that under New York law at that time, for a lesbian as opposed to a gay man, and the laws were very different, but for a lesbian, what was illegal back then was kind of appearing or dressing as a man. So Edie, who was convinced that they were on to her and they were going to ask her if she was a lesbian, and her fear was justified, by the way. It was a felony at that point in time to be a homosexual and to have any employment whatsoever with the federal government. In fact, Edie went on to an illustrious career at IBM, and for most of the time she was at IBM, it was technically at least illegal because IBM itself had many contracts with the federal government. Anyway, She's determined that she's going to tell the truth if she's asked the right question, but hoping to throw the FBI off their game, she shows up at the interview in high heels, a frilly dress, and crinolines. Fortunately for Edie, and I would venture to say fortunately for this country, the only questions that the FBI asked her were about her sister's friends who were in the teachers' union, who they thought probably were communists. They didn't ask her any questions about whether or not she was a lesbian and she got the security clearance. Another great story legally. Why? Because another one of the arguments that people used to use, again, the arguments have really changed over time. This argument is even used today. But another one of the arguments that people used to use about why it's okay to treat gay people differently is, yeah, you know, there used to be discrimination against gay people, but we don't have it anymore. It didn't really last very long, and it wasn't very much of a big deal. Now, there are all kinds of academic stories. There's historians and books that you can use that we did, in fact, use in our case to kind of prove that that isn't true. But to be able to tell this story itself from Edie Windsor's own life, imagine today, I mean, with this group, I guess people can't imagine. When I speak to younger audiences, they look at me with their eyes agape. But imagine being told that if you go into an interview under oath and if you tell the truth about who you really are, not only would she lose her job, her whole career would have been ruined. That was the reality that gay people lived in during this period. Okay, let me try to kind of forward it to Edie, how the case developed. So Edie, she's working at IBM after getting her master's. She gets a fellowship to study at Harvard. It turns out that was the wrong school to choose because at Harvard they weren't really doing computer programming back then and they weren't doing computer languages. So she had a kind of a miserable time. And after a year there, she says to IBM, can I please come home and have my job back? And they say, fine. She goes, comes back, she's living on the Upper West Side, and she's very lonely. She said back then on the Upper West Side, she was the only woman in her entire building who wore jeans. And she calls a friend who was a lesbian one day, kind of desperately lonely, and says to her, please, if you know where the lesbians are, can you please take me? And her friend takes her to a restaurant in the village on a Friday night called the Portofino Restaurant. It was a restaurant that was then managed by Elaine Kaufman, who went on to start Elaine's on the Upper East Side. And it turns out that on Friday nights, the lesbians hung out at the Portofino. Edie's having dinner, and brought over to her table is a woman by the name of Thea Spire. Now, let me kind of contrast a little bit the backgrounds of Edie and Thea. Thea was also Jewish, but from a very different background. Her family came from Amsterdam. They were, for anyone who knows about Dutch Jews, they were the Spire Pickle family of Amsterdam. They were very wealthy. Thea spoke a zillion languages. She was a concert, almost concert-level violinist. She had low handicap in golf, as if you're good, I think, right? Very low handicap in golf. Her family had left Amsterdam just kind of as the Nazis were coming over and taking power. She moved to London with her stepmom. Her mother had died when she was an infant. And then her father kind of joined them just as the Nazis were invading. And then they ultimately moved to Westchester. From Edie's perspective, it was love at first sight. But from Thea's perspective, as these things go in life, not so much. And for about 2 years, Edie would kind of see Thea at parties. They would always dance together. The first night, Edie said that they danced so long, Edie wore a hole in her stocking. But Thea had a series of girlfriends, and she wasn't particularly interested. Until finally, Edie heard from some friends that Thea was single and that she was spending the weekend in the Hamptons. So Edie called some people she knew not that well and said, would you mind terribly if I come stay with you in the Hamptons this weekend? The people said, fine. And there's this incredible story of her kind of going out there and waiting and waiting and waiting for Thea to show up. She finally does, and that was the beginning of their relationship. 2 years later, in a fact that really never ceases to kind of astonish me, they were driving out to the Hamptons. Thea pulled over by the side of the road and pulled out a circular diamond brooch that I hope and believe will one day go to the Smithsonian and said to Edie, will you marry me? First of all, why did she use the circular diamond brooch? Well, Thea had kind of conned Edie. She said to Edie, you know, Edie, if you showed up at work with an engagement ring at IBM, what would happen? And Edie's like, I can't do that. She said, if I show up at IBM wearing an engagement ring, everyone's going to say, who's the lucky guy? She's like, I can't answer that question. So, you know, maybe a circular pin, but I can't wear an engagement ring. It turns out when Edie was at IBM, she would often get a lot of questions about who this woman Thea is. And Edie's stock answer to those questions was that Thea was the sister of a guy she was dating by the name of Willie. It turns out there is a Willie Spire. He's a wooden doll from Amsterdam. He actually still is sitting in Edie's closet. I've seen him with my own eyes. But again, it kind of gives you a sense of what things were like. Edie remained closeted her entire working career at IBM. So the other amazing, really truly astonishing fact of that is the fact that it even occurred to Thea, that Thea even had the idea enter her head, even though obviously they had no expectation that they would get married, that the idea that two women could become engaged at that time in 1967 is astonishing. Among other things, that was 2 years before Stonewall. Stonewall is what kind of began the modern gay civil rights movement. The idea that 2 years before Stonewall, two women could even have the thought enter their brains is simply amazing. The truly heroic part of their lives, however, was what happened the next 44 years. Thea, after about 10 or 15 years into their relationship, was diagnosed with a horrible form of multiple sclerosis. Over time, she lost the use of her legs and then her arms. By the time she died, she was a quadriplegic. And they had a refrigerator magnet on the refrigerator that said, don't postpone joy. And they really lived according to that motto. There's no question about it. In fact, on the day that Thea died, she was a psychologist, and she actually had patients who she was supposed to see that day, who had to be told what had happened. They went on, they had this very rich life, travel and friends and, you know, everything one would want in terms of a couple. And in 2007, Thea, who had a bad heart as well, got a very bad diagnosis from her doctor. And if you're a quadriplegic, getting surgery in the hospital is really hard because you can't kind of tell people what you want. And she was unwilling to have the surgery. And the doctor said to her, then you really don't have much longer to live. In the past, they had been waiting to get married in New York. They were unable to do so, and that's my fault, frankly. I argued the New York marriage case in the New York Court of Appeals in 2006 and lost it. And they were kind of waiting and waiting and waiting. And Edie, at one point before this diagnosis, had said to Thea, do you want to go up to Toronto to get married? And Thea had said, no, I don't. It's too hard to travel. The day after she got that diagnosis, however, she woke up in the morning and she said to Edie, do you still want to get married? And Edie said, I do. And they went to Toronto with four best women and two best men, including people who could disassemble and reassemble the electric wheelchair. They were married in the Toronto Airport Hilton, so they could just kind of wheel Thea in. They wouldn't have to have too much trouble getting around Toronto. That was a couple who really, really, really wanted to get married, right? Unfortunately, the diagnosis proved to be correct. Thea died in 2009, and that's how the case began. Because of this statute known as the so-called Defense of Marriage Act, Thea and Edie, for purposes of federal law, even though they were married and that marriage was recognized under New York law, for purposes of the federal government, their marriage was null and void. It didn't exist. And what that meant is that it was even all the assets that they had kind of accumulated together and that Edie inherited from Thea and her family upon Thea's death were treated for tax purposes as if they were the assets from a stranger, a gift from a stranger. That meant that Edie was hit with a huge inheritance tax bill, $363,000, a bill that she said in a remarkably prescient statement of what was to come made her feel indignant. She and Justice Kennedy were clearly on the same brainwave, made her feel indignant, and she went around looking for a lawyer to bring the case. Now, that's where I get lucky. What first happened is she went around to some of the civil rights groups and was turned down. And then she had a mutual friend. She had a friend who's a friend of mine, and she said to her friend, can you help me find a lawyer? And he said, I think I know some people. Do you mind if I have them call you? And he called me the next day. Now, here's the truly amazing part of the case. When I got that call, I had never laid eyes on Edie Windsor. I had no idea who she was. But when my friend told me that she had been married to Thea Spire, I knew exactly who she was. And the reason for that is that 18 years before then, I had been in my third year of law school. And I think it's fair for me to say that I was not exactly kind of a radical revolutionary in terms of the coming out process. Unlike my wife, who was kind of protesting the closing of the lesbian co-op at Smith and kind of doing all kinds of stuff, I was kind of on the, no pun intended, on the straight and narrow, working really hard, studying really hard. At that point in time, you know, going on to a firm like Paul Weiss. And I really, even though I thought about it in college and even though I thought about it in law school, I really waited until the bitter end of my third year in law school to finally have the courage to come out. My bad luck, just when I was doing that, my parents were coming to visit me from Cleveland. And my even worse luck, the weekend they were coming to visit, turns out it was Gay Pride. So I was living, like Edie, I was living in a studio apartment on the Upper West Side, and my parents are coming to visit, and they kind of have to wind their way through the Gay Pride traffic to get to my apartment. By the time they get there, I think it's fair to say they were in a state. I don't remember exactly what my mom said, but I know she talked about the dykes on bikes, and what's with all the rainbows, and what are they all so proud about? And one of my college roommates' mom was then the Manhattan Borough President, Ruth Messinger, and my mom, who led the parade. And my mom said, "What's Ruth Messinger doing, leading this parade?" On and on. And I said to my mom, "Stop, enough, stop." And as mothers and daughters are kind of wont to do, my mom continued. And I said, Beseder, you know, stop again. And she said, why? You know, why are you telling me to stop? Are you gay? And I said, yes. And she went about 3 feet, it was a small apartment, over to the wall of the studio and literally started banging her head against the wall. You can laugh. I mean, it kind of feels like a Seinfeld episode today. That was way before Seinfeld. It did not feel like a Seinfeld episode back then. Let me be clear. This is not about, I mean, I feel like it's a mold of our film. This is not about my mother. My mom has apologized for this about 10 gazillion times. She could not be more proud, both of my parents, more proud of who I am today. Apparently, my father, no matter where he is standing in line, whether it's at the drugstore or the grocery store or the barbershop, manages to get out to whoever he's sitting next to that his daughter had a big case in the Supreme Court. So, you know, my parents, like so many others, evolved, and this is not to criticize my parents. But as you can imagine, I was pretty low after that happened, and I was living in New York. I was about to move to Boston to clerk, and I started asking around. I said, this is the way people talk back then, I need a psychologist who is good at gay issues. And I kept getting the same name. The name I kept getting was Thea Speier. So I actually saw, this was not disclosed in our brief to the Supreme Court, as you can imagine, but I actually saw Thea Speier as a patient only 2 times, because I was only in New York probably for about another month and a half that summer. I saw her in Edie's apartment because she was already paralyzed. So she saw patients in her apartment, the same apartment Edie lives in today. And here's the truly most incredible fact. During those sessions, she talked about Edie. Now, I'm just a poor country lawyer. I'm not a psychologist, but I understand that it's a little unusual for psychologists to tell a patient about their own life. And I've spent a lot of time thinking about why she did that. I didn't talk to Edie about it. I think the answer is crystal clear. I was so despondent at that time, so cynical at the idea that I could ever have the kind of life that I wanted to have, that I could have a Jewish home and be married and have a kid and all the stuff I wanted, all the stuff I grew up with, that Thea was convinced that the only way she could persuade me that I could have that is by telling me about her own relationship. So she talked to me, and she talked about this woman, Edie Windsor, and they'd been together for 40 years, and Edie was a brilliant mathematician, and she studied at NYU. For some reason, I had an idea that she was a professor at NYU, but she was this math person at NYU. I remember hearing the whole thing. And I never saw Thea again. I clerked for a year in Boston. I came back to New York. During each gay pride parade, she often would be sitting in her wheelchair at the foot of their building, which is at 2 Fifth Avenue, right of Washington Square Park. I would always look to see if she was there, but I never said anything to her. Flash forward 18 years, I have the phone call with Edie. I said, I'm going to come over tomorrow. Edie's pretty hard of hearing, so I thought we should meet in person. I didn't have to ask her where to go. I knew where to go. I showed up the next day at her apartment. I opened the door. I looked in her living room where I used to sit with Thea, and it was like kind of like coming back to the scene of an accident. Like all those emotions that I'd experienced so long ago came back to me. I said to Edie, you have to give me a minute. I've been here before. And I explained to her why. Then I said to her, and I remember this like it was yesterday, boy, you really don't look like I expected you to look. And this is where I guess we all have all kinds of bias still, because I had kind of imagined she was like this math geek is what I thought. So I kind of imagined like a woman in thick glasses and maybe like a flannel shirt and kind of like a pocket with a slide rule or something. And when I took one look at Edie, I was like, oh my God, that's not what I imagined. And then I remember thinking, I knew if I said it, I would sound completely mashugana, but I remember thinking to myself that God was giving me this chance to pay Thea back for everything that she'd done for me, and that I was going to do it. So that is the official beginning of United States v. Windsor. Again, not a story that was told until I wrote the book. But now let's get to the official story, which is the Supreme Court on March 27, 2013. So what I'm going to do is take kind of the snippets from the argument as they occurred chronologically. We get to start with the justice, also known as notorious RBG. I wouldn't use that, except for she has embraced the term. I wouldn't do anything that Justice Ginsburg doesn't like, but she has embraced this term. And you're going to hear right now why she so richly deserves the phrase notorious RBG.
The no joint appearance, no marital adoption, no social security benefits. Your spouse is very sick, but you can't get leave. People, if that set of attributes, one might well ask, what kind of marriage is this? There's not a question of additional benefits. I mean, they touch every aspect of life. Your partner is sick. Social Security. I mean, it's pervasive. It's not as though, well, there's this little federal sphere, and it's only in a tax question. It's as Justice Kennedy said, 1100 statutes, and it affects every area of life. And so we would be really diminishing what the state has said is marriage. You're saying, no, state, there are two kinds of marriages. The full marriage, and then the sort of scandal marriage.
So what you just heard was actually much louder than what I heard in the court that day. Kind of what you heard, what I heard in the court today was the volume, like, before she turned it up. And when Justice Ginsburg said this, I actually hadn't heard what she said. I heard people laughing. I knew it was good. But I hadn't heard it. And I turned to my co-counsel, Pam Carlin, a professor at Stanford. And I said, what did she just say? And when Pam told me that she had said skim milk marriage, I'm really not exaggerating, I almost had to hold my arm down. Like, I wanted to do this in the middle of the Supreme Court, and I realized that would probably be bad form. Why? You know, we had spent, I wish I had kept track of it, I can't tell you, countless hours in the case, kind of agonizing and thinking and like only the way only lawyers, particularly Jewish lawyers, can do, about how to best express this concept that by treating the marriages of straight couples one way as valid and treating the marriages of gay couples as another way as invalid, that DOMA created a kind of second-class citizenship that was totally, totally foreign to and inconsistent with the Constitution. And we literally, you know, when you're writing a Supreme Court brief, we like to use different words and different phrases, and, you know, the brief itself went through hundreds of drafts. But in her own inimitable way, notorious RBG, off the cuff, which she's since confirmed, kind of came up with a phrase, this skim milk marriage phrase, that so encapsulated exactly what we wanted to say so much better than anything we had said in our own brief. So I was feeling pretty good when I heard that. The other thing that I you might have caught that's very, very typical of Supreme Court arguments, at least in the era of Justice Scalia, so the kind of recent era, and may continue, may not continue, was the emphasis on Justice Kennedy. Did you hear, I don't know if you caught it, but did you hear Justice Ginsburg say, as Justice Kennedy said? Much of what Supreme Court arguments have been like in high-profile cases like Windsor or the Obamacare cases or any cases like that, affirmative action, is kind of both sides of the court lobbying Justice Kennedy. And your job as an advocate, really, frankly, is to kind of help the justices on your side lobby Justice Kennedy against the justices on the other side. That's really, it's very different than being in other courts. So what Justice Ginsburg did here is very, very typical. And she's kind of, and both sides did it. We had decided when we were preparing that for me to say, go out up there and stand and say, as Justice Kennedy said, would probably be a little too obvious. So what we did instead, although I'm not sure we scored points for subtlety, is that we took what were then Justice Kennedy's two great gay rights decisions. He's now written four. But his two great gay rights decisions at that point, which were Romer and Lawrence, and we took the best language out of them. We called it Kennedy's Greatest Hits. We had it down on a two-page piece of paper, and I literally walked through the streets of Washington, D.C., saying them out loud for about 48 hours. The reason is I wanted to be able to use his language without quoting him, and I wanted to have it on the tip of my tongue. We actually had a bet on our team as to whether or not I would succeed. I did. You'll hear it later. I still haven't collected on the bet, but I think that's okay. I'm going to go on now. The next excerpt is from another one of the Jewish women justices from New York City, Justice Kagan. And this is another thing that happened prior. This is all before I even got up to speak that was making me feel pretty good.
For the most part, and historically, the only uniformity that the federal government has pursued is that it's uniformly recognized the marriages that are recognized by the state. So this was a real difference in the uniformity that the federal government was pursuing. And it suggests that maybe something, maybe Congress had something different in mind than uniformity. So we have a whole series of cases which suggest the following, which suggests that when Congress targets a group that is not everybody's favorite group in the world, that we look at those cases with some, even if they're not suspect, with some rigor to say, do we really think that Congress was doing this for uniformity reasons? Or do we think that Congress's judgment was affected by dislike, by fear, by animus, and so forth? I guess the question that this statute raises, this statute that does something that's really never been done before, is whether that sends up a pretty good red flag that that's what was going on.
The other point I would make, but I also eventually want to get around to Anna's point, but the other point I would make is, when you look at Congress doing something that is unusual, it deviates from the way they've done proceeded in the past, you have to ask, well, was there a good reason? And in a sense, you have to understand that in 1996, something's happening that is, in a sense, forcing Congress to choose between its historic practice of deferring to the states and its historic practice of preferring uniformity. Up until 1996, it essentially has it both ways. Every state has the traditional definition. Congress knows that's the definition that's embedded in every federal law. It says, fine, we defer. Okay, 1996.
Well, here's what happened in 1996, and I'm going to quote from the House report here, is that Congress decided to reflect and honor a collective moral judgment and to express moral disapproval of homosexuality. Is that what happened in 1996?
Does the House report say that? Of course the House report says that. And if that's enough to invalidate the statute, then you should invalidate the statute. But that's never been your approach, especially under rational basis or even rational basis plus, if that's what you're suggesting.
Okay, 3 points about this. So first, this was another one of those church lady moments. First of all, if you ever have a choice in life, I'm not sure many of us ever will, but if you ever have a choice in life between being cross-examined by Justice Kagan or being cross-examined by any other human being on the planet, I personally would choose any other human being on the planet. This Paul Clement, my adversary, is probably the best Supreme Court advocate, certainly of my generation, certainly maybe of any generation. He was superb during this argument. But even he, I think, and I've never seen him quite this way, was rattled by this cross-examination. Justice Kagan had prepared this. There's no question about that. She, you know, it was all laid out in her mind, at least, when it came up. And one of the reasons why we were so thrilled is because what she was articulating here was one of our other core themes in the case, which was in 1996, when Congress passed DOMA, it's almost incredible to think about it at the time, it was completely a theoretical statute. What I mean by that is gay people weren't getting married anywhere in the United States of America in 1996. There was really no prospect of it happening in 1996. There had kind of been a glimmerings in Hawaii, but that was quickly shut down. Marriages did not start between gay people in the United States until 2003 in Massachusetts. So what in the world was Congress doing in 1996, passing a statute that really had no effect on anyone, other than to say that if it ever happens in the future that gay people get to get married, for the federal government's perspective, those marriages are null and void, right? Call me crazy, but Congress generally, I don't know if they pass statutes anymore, period, but they're generally not in the business of passing theoretical statutes. So you kind of have to think to yourself, what were they doing? What was behind this? What we, of course, wanted to express in our case, in part because it was true, but in part because it fit well within Justice Kennedy's jurisprudence, was this idea that DOMA was truly unusual. It was unique. It was Congress expressing either a dislike of gay people, a fear of gay people. Going back to 1996, it was kind of the height of the AIDS crisis, kind of a fear of gays. That is the kind, if that's the motivation behind a statute, that's not constitutionally okay. It's a constitutional no-no. And this is something we tried really hard in our briefs to express. There was a section of the brief I called the checklist section. I probably rewrote more than any other section that kind of tried to make this argument. And for Justice Kagan to be expressing it, again, before I even had a chance to speak, was obviously a very, very good sign. Now, one of the other things I was obsessed with on this was that, as you probably all know, DOMA was signed into law by President Clinton. And this was one of my crazy obsessions. I was really worried that when I got up there to speak, that the justices, particularly the conservative justices, would all hammer in on the fact that, are you saying, Ms. Kaplan, after all, it was passed by majorities in Congress, it was widely, you know, popular, widely approved, it was signed into law by President Clinton, are you saying that President Clinton was a homophobe? I was convinced that I would get that question. So in order to head it off, several weeks before the briefs were due, I actually called a good friend of mine who worked for the Clintons, is very close to the Clintons, and I said, look, this is honestly what I said. I'm a little bit ashamed of my chutzpah, but this is honestly what I said. I said, I want you to call the president, and I want you to tell him that, like everyone else, President Clinton is going to have to meet his maker, that we all have to meet our maker one day, and that he will too, and that I know that signing DOMA into law is not something that he is proud of. It's not something that he feels good about. It's not something that he would do again. And it would be very helpful for us if he expressed that view. But if he's going to do it, he's got to do it now. Because if he does it after the argument, it does us no good at all. To his great credit, I mean, I'll kind of give it my spiel about this, but to his great credit, 2 weeks before the oral argument, President Clinton published an op-ed in the Washington Post. As far as I'm known, it's unprecedented for a former president to do this, saying that he signed DOMA into law, that it was based on a misunderstanding of gay people and their relationships, that it was wrong, and that in his view it was unconstitutional. Let me give you my spiel on this. I think here we are kind of in the heart of Washington, D.C., and I think particularly times today have gotten only worse. It's very easy, I think, in our world to become very cynical. And you watch MSNBC, and you watch Fox, and you look at Twitter, and it's very easy to kind of fall prey to this view that everything that anyone does, particularly here in D.C., is based on some motive that may not have to do with the merits, or based on principle. But sometimes, actually, politicians or elected officials actually do things because it's the right thing to do. In both President Clinton's decision to publish that op-ed and President Obama's decision, which I don't have time to talk about, not to defend DOMA at the very beginning of the case, in my view, are kind of examples of an antidote, I hope, to that kind of cynicism. Because there's no other reason they did it other than to do the right thing. I think those are the points I want to make about that. Let's go really quickly to the opening, and then we'll get to the fun part, which is when they start mixing it up with me. Although, I can say it's fun now. It wasn't really fun then.
Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the Court, I'd like to focus on why DOMA fails even under rationality review. Because of DOMA, many thousands of people who are legally married under the laws of 9 sovereign states and the District of Columbia are being treated as unmarried by the federal government solely because they are gay. These couples are being treated as unmarried with respect to programs that affect family stability, such as the Family Leave Act, referred to by Justice Ginsburg. These couples are being treated as unmarried for purposes of federal conflict of interest rules, election laws, and anti-nepotism and judicial recusal statutes. And my client was treated as unmarried when her spouse passed away, so that she had to pay $363,000 in estate taxes on the property that they had accumulated during their 44 years together.
So when you argue at the Supreme Court, you know that you have something like 20 to 40 seconds to speak uninterrupted. And as you can imagine, you spend a lot of time thinking about and worrying about what you're going to say in that opening. This was, again, probably the 952nd draft of the opening that we kind of worked on over and over and over again in terms of what I was going to say. And it's obvious, I think, what we were trying to do. We wanted to talk about the breadth of DOMA, the irrationality of DOMA, and then kind of focus in, as we had throughout the whole case, on our client's story. But this actually isn't the opening I went in there with. One of the examples that I had, the prime example that I was going to use, was the impact of DOMA on the military, which we thought was a very good argument for Justice Kennedy. What I mean by that is, after the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell, as you can imagine, there were a lot of married gay soldiers in the military. And it very quickly became a problem because one or more of those soldiers actually got very seriously injured or even killed in the course of their duty. Now, I'm sure I don't have to tell you that in the military, how you notify the next of kin of that is a big deal. It's part of military culture and military honor. And you obviously notify the spouse. But under DOMA, they couldn't notify the spouse because the spouse wasn't a spouse for purposes of federal law. And I can't tell you, I know for a fact, that this was absolutely agonizing to the Pentagon. They absolutely found this to be such a horrible indignity that it was driving them crazy. So we had a big example about this in my opening. Unfortunately or fortunately, depending on how you look at it, the Solicitor General Don Verrilli went before me. He was now on our side of the case, and he used that example in his opening. We had coordinated with them, but I didn't know he was going to use it, so I had to quickly kind of scratch it out and put something else in. Let's get to the two or three examples. I think it's two, where I kind of mix it up with some of the other justices. I'll talk about that, and then we'll go to questions. Okay.
There's a little doubt that the answer to the question of why Congress singled out gay people's marriages for disrespect to DOMA, the answer can't be uniformity, as we discussed. It can't be cost savings, because you still have to explain then why cost savings is being wrought at the expense of married couples who are gay. And it can't be any of the state interests that weren't discussed, but questions of family law and parenting and marriage are done by the states, not by the federal government. The only conclusion that could be drawn is what was in the House report, which is moral disapproval of gay people, which the Congress thought was permissible in 1996 because it relied on the Court's Powers decision, but the Court has said was wrong not only at the time it was overruled in Lawrence, but was wrong when it was decided.
So 84, it's the same question I asked before, 84 senators based their vote on moral disapproval of gay people?
No, I think what's true, Mr. Chief Justice, is that times can blind, and that back in 1996, people did not have the understanding that they have today, that there was no distinction. There was no constitutionally permissible distinction.
Well, does that mean times can blind? Does that mean they did not base their votes on moral disapproval?
You know, some clearly did. I think it was based on an understanding that gay couples were fundamentally different than straight couples, an understanding that I don't think exists today, and that's the sense I'm using, the times can blind. I think that was, we all can understand that people have moved on this and now understand that there is no such distinction. So I'm not saying it was animus or bigotry. I think it was based on a misunderstanding of gay people.
Why are you so confident in that judgment? How many states permit gay couples to marry?
Today, nine, Your Honor.
And so there's been this sea change between now and 1996.
I think with respect to the understanding of gay people in their relationship, there has been a sea change.
So this is where I won the bet. Times can blind comes from Justice Kennedy's decision in Lawrence. I don't, as I said before, I don't think I scored any points for subtlety. When I said it, I could see the chief's eyes kind of get very big. He knew what I was doing. Everyone on that court knew what I was doing. He used the same words in asking questions back to me. But in a lot of ways, I think that expression, times can blind, really actually conveyed exactly what I was trying to do. You know, I didn't want to accuse either Bill Clinton or, frankly, many of the other people who voted for DOMA of being homophobes. I don't think they were. I think that what happened is that people have a changed understanding. And I wanted to kind of, not only because I think it's true, but I wanted to give the justices an out. I didn't want this to be, it didn't have to be that in order for us to win the case, the court had to conclude that the majority of Congress or the president or anyone else was a homophobe. We weren't going to win the case that way. So times can blind, just as Justice Kennedy said in Lawrence, was actually the perfect kind of answer or solution to that problem. I'm going to play a continuation of kind of this exchange.
I suppose the sea change has a lot to do with the political force and effectiveness of people representing, supporting your side of the case.
I disagree with that, Mr. Chief Justice. I think the sea change has to do, just as was discussed in Bowers and Morris, with an understanding that there was no difference, there was no fundamental difference that could justify this kind of quota categorical discrimination between gay couples.
You don't doubt that the lobby supporting the enactment of same-sex marriage laws in different states is politically powerful, do you?
With respect to that category, that characterization of the term for purposes of time scrutiny, I would, Your Honor. I don't
really?
Yes.
As far as I can tell, political thinkers are falling over themselves to endorse your side of the case.
The fact of the matter is, Mr. Chief Justice, is that no other group in recent history has been subjected to popular referendum to take away rights that have already been given or exclude those rights the way gay people have. And only two of those referenda have ever lost. One was in Arizona and then passed a couple of years later. One was in Minnesota where they already have a statute on the books that prohibits marriages between gay people. So I don't think, and until 1990, gay people were not allowed to enter this country. So I don't think that the political power of gay people today could possibly be seen within that framework. It certainly is analogous. I think gay people are far weaker than women were at the time of frontier.
Well, you just referred to a sea change in people's understandings and values from 1996, when Goodman was enacted. I'm just trying to see where that comes from, if not from the political effectiveness of groups on your side of the case.
To flip the language of the House report, Mr. Chief Justice, I think it comes from a moral understanding today that gay people are no different, and that gay married couples' relationships are not significantly different than the relationship straight married couples.
So, a couple things. So, first of all, this was the Clinton op-ed coming back to haunt me, right? There's no way that the Chief Justice wasn't thinking about Clinton's op-ed when he asked me these questions. Whenever we do things, they always have consequences that we're not going to know about, as an example. During this portion of, I mean, my parents were there the whole time, obviously, sitting in the court and watching the argument. Afterwards, my mom came up to me and she said, during this part of the argument when the Chief Justice said, really? And I answered the question. My mom said she was totally petrified because she thought that meant a bunch of marshals were going to kind of come over and put me in handcuffs and take me away. When I listened to this portion of the tape, and this is a kind of a insight that only occurred to me several months ago, I hear something that I've become aware of, and let me try to explain a little bit. It was very important for me in the case. I had a post-it that I kept on my computer that said, it's all about Edie Stupid. You know, borrowing from the first Clinton campaign. And the reason I had that on there was because, as I said before, our whole strategy was if we could convince the court that Edie's marriage to Theo was no different than the marriages that they had with their own spouses, then we would win the case. I think in retrospect, I had it up for another reason as well. I think I was trying to at least subconsciously remind myself that even though DOMA was a law that impacted me as a married lesbian, that my duty as a lawyer, which is true in any case, is to think only about my client. And to the greatest extent possible, to kind of put my own stuff behind me and not think about it and only focus on Edie. And I think for the most part, I have to say, I think I succeeded in doing that. There were moments, however, when the Robbie Kaplan part of the case, I just couldn't keep it down anymore. And when I hear that portion of the testimony, I hear my voice crack, when I say until 1990 and my voice cracks, that was Robbie Kaplan. It couldn't came up and I couldn't hold it down. Again, I don't think actually it was a bad thing. I don't think it was lost on the justices that in 2 days of arguments between the Perry case and the Windsor case, that I was the first openly gay person to get up and address them. So I actually think it ended up being effective. One more thing and then we'll take questions. When you have a Supreme Court argument like this, and this was my first, you go through this process of what are called moot courts, where a bunch of lawyers and law professors, Supreme Court practitioners get in a room, and they pretend they're the justices, and they grill you for about 45 minutes, and then they spend about another hour kind of critiquing everything you said. We did about 7 or 8 formal moots, and we did dozens and dozens of informal moots. I don't know, maybe surgery without anesthesia would be more painful, but I'm not necessarily sure about that. And so pretty much every answer I gave was something that we'd practiced over and over and over and over again, except for the last answer you heard. When the idea that I should say to the justice what had changed was a flip or the opposite of the language in the House report that you heard Justice Kagan talk about, a flip from a moral disapproval in 1996 to a moral understanding today, that thought literally just kind of shot into my head right there. I remember thinking to myself, oh God, like I can't turn around and vet this with Pam Carlin. I think it's good. I can't think of anything negative about it. I'm just going to go for it. And I think in a lot of ways it was the best answer I gave all day long, but it was the only answer that we didn't rehearse over and over and over again. So I'll quickly go through a map. That's the way the country looked when we filed Windsor in terms of marriage equality. You'll see again that New York was not a marriage equality state. That's the way the country looked just prior to the decision in Obergefell. There, we went from 5 states to 9 states by the time of argument, to 12 states when we won, to 37 states just before Obergefell. So it truly was, Justice Scalia had that one right, it truly was a sea change. Thank you so much.
If you have a question, the basket will be going around. We'll give an opportunity to take a card. If you just raise your hand if you have a question, they'll deliver a card and a pencil to you. I'd like to call upon Leslie Maitland, the chair of our Amram Scholar Series, to give you a little bit of a preview of who's up next. Leslie, thank you so much.
Thank you, Rabbi, and thank you, Robbie Kaplan. I think everyone will agree that it's totally brilliant. Brilliant lawyer. She didn't tell you this, but she was 31 when she was made a partner at Paul Weiss. Incredible. And her book is so beautifully written, so honest, so personal. So it really brings the law alive in the most humane, human possible way. And so I hope you'll all buy it and enjoy it. I'd like to thank also the Leo and Elizabeth Goodman Public Issues Endowment Fund and the Jewish Book Council for making this possible. We have just 2 more programs in the Amram Scholar Series this season. The next one is on Sunday, May the 1st at 10:30 a.m. Israeli-American clinical psychologist and author Elon Grotch will speak about his new book, The Israeli Mind, How the Israeli National Character Shapes Our World. He presents a compelling if disturbing portrait of the Israeli national character. Israelis, he says, are grand and grandiose, visionary and delusional, generous and self-centered. Deeply caring because of the history of Jewish victimization, they also demonstrate a shocking indifference to the suffering of others. So this promises to be perhaps a controversial lecture, but very interesting. On Sunday, June the 5th, we will wrap up at 6 p.m., and it's sort of unusual time for us, with a lecture accompanied by a concert by Steve Katz, who was a founding member of both the Blues Project and Blood, Sweat, and Tears. And he will discuss his memoir of a Jewish boy as rock star in his new book called Blood, Sweat, and My Rock and Roll Years. So please join us. Thank you.
And no need to be shy. If I could take Justice Scalia's questions, you don't have to be shy.
But he's scaffolding. I want to ask you, what was the most important thing you learned in this process?
God, there's so many. I'd say a couple things. First of all, in addition to it being an incredible experience, as you can imagine, the one thing that was really true from the minute we filed the case to the minute we went at the Supreme Court was we had an incredible amount of fun. We laughed like crazy on our team. I'm sure we have reunions already, but I'm sure we'll be friends for life. Pam Carlin, who's one of the most brilliant constitutional lawyers of our time, who I didn't know before the case at all, I called her up on July 4th, 2012 and said, hey, you want to work on this case? And she then was supposed to go on a sabbatical to Italy and canceled her sabbatical to do so. Has become one of my dearest friends. She's my son's trustee. I'll give you a sense of how close we are. And so in a lot of ways, that's the thing about the case I think that I will carry on with me the most, was kind of the relationships and the friendship. I think the other thing, which is kind of related to that, is to go with your gut. We really... In the case, there were a lot of people involved. There were a lot of movement lawyers involved, a lot of organizations. And we really had a kind of a practice of listening to what people had to say, of having I'm not known for my patience, so of having what I thought were interminable conference calls, listening to all the various viewpoints, but of always making the decision of what we were going to do based on one criteria and one criteria only, which is, would it help Edie Windsor get her money back? And that's something I learned kind of as a practicing lawyer at Paul Weiss, which is, that's what I do in most of my cases, is help my clients get their money back. And it had a really, I think, purifying impact on the case, because we were able to tell the story and to litigate the case from Edie's perspective, and I think that made it so much more powerful.
Can you comment and speak to the role of the faith communities during the case? How did it grow from USSB to the reform movement impact the case at all?
Well, it actually had a big impact. So, you know, I already referred to some of my obsessions. One of my other obsessions in the case was the religious issue, because I felt, and I still feel, that lawyers in our movement, one of the mistakes that our movement has made, was ceding the religious arguments to the other side. So allowing the perception out there, allowing there to be a perception out there that religious people were anti-gay rights. And surely there were 90 amicus briefs filed in Windsor, and of the 45 briefs that were filed by the other side, I'd say 44 of them, if not 45 of them, were all devoted to that argument. This argument that I'm a religious, often evangelical Christian, Catholic, whatever, and that I believe in certain religious principles about the sanctity of man-woman marriage, and somehow recognizing in a civil context the equality of gay people offends my religion. So I thought it was very important that we express to the court that not all religious people had that view, and that there are plenty of religious people on the other side. And so in the past, in these cases, most of the religious amicus briefs that have been filed had kind of been from gay religious groups. So in New York, CBST, which is the big synagogue, was always filing. There would be the kind of the gay Catholics, the gay Presbyterians, et cetera. It was very important to me for the first time that we have a mainstream religious brief. So we ultimately got a brief that came from, obviously, the Reform Movement, who was already on board, a lot of Episcopal bishops, a lot of Methodists. It was all mainstream, non-gay, mainstream religious groups. And most importantly, from my perspective, we got the entire conservative movement on board. It was the first amicus brief that the Jewish Theological Seminary had ever filed in its history. And they filed it in this case. And there's a whole story about that I tell in my book. There was an intense lobbying effort.
A little bit about your rabbi and what she did.
Yeah, there's an intense lobbying effort that went on with my rabbi, Jan Erbach, who teaches at the seminary, and Julie Schoenfeld, who's the head of United Synagogue, where we kind of went piece by piece. The three pillars of the conservative movement are United Synagogue, the Rabbinical Assembly, and JTS. And we got them one by one, so that finally JTS was the only one that was left out, and we basically said, look, if United Synagogue and the Rabbinical Assembly are on and you're not, it's going to look terrible. And to their credit, and Arnie Eisen, the chancellor, deserves enormous credit for this. They did. I think it's one of the things that he's most proud of. I'd like to think it had a big impact on the case. I have no idea. I'm pretty sure that Justice Kagan and Justice Ginsburg and probably Breyer noticed. But it was something that was very important to me. And now in every gay rights case since then, the same version of the mainstream religious brief has been filed.
How, in years to come, will the analysis, the looking at this case in a historic perspective, be viewed that the lead lawyer, the two individuals, were all Jewish?
How will it be looked at? I don't know. I mean, sure, there'll be plenty of people who don't like the case and will say all kinds of things, like the kinds of things, unfortunately, we're hearing today in the popular media. You know, I think for at least me, I mean, you know, believe it or not, Rabbi, my Torah portion, and I don't even know what year it was, in the 70s, was Tzedek Tzedek Tirdof. I'm not silly enough to think that's what drove me to do this case. Obviously, it wasn't. But there's no doubt that my religious beliefs and my views about tikkun olam have kind of led, it's why I went to Paul Weiss in the first place, because that's the kind of work we do at Paul Weiss in terms of, we didn't charge Edie a penny for this case, by the way, in terms of pro bono work, and it's what kind of drives my passion as a lawyer. And I think certainly true for Pam Carlin, and certainly true for Edie.
Can you speak a little bit about how an advantage it was that when you began to write this brief, that you made a choice which you said is the style, I believe, in the book that Paul Weiss does there. I think it's briefs. Forgive me. When you began to write the, I guess, is it the complaint?
The complaint.
That you wrote it in a very narrative form as opposed to an alternative form. How important was that, that you already had that sort of background? Because if I read the book correctly, the real push of this and the real weight of this was the impact of this 44-year marriage. And when we hear the justice saying the indignity over and over again, you can't hear their story and can't hear the effect of that marriage. And talk a little bit, I mean, first about that narrative style, and then a little bit, if you will, about the marriage and the film and the impact that may have.
So, it's actually very interesting. If you look back, when I lost the marriage case in New York in 2006, and you flash forward to the winning of Obergefell in 2015, and you look at the briefs that were filed in those two cases, they actually look very similar. The legal arguments between, the 2000s, even when Mary Bonato won her case in 2003, and the arguments that were made at the Supreme Court last spring and summer, are not that different. The arguments are the same. What has changed is not the arguments. It's certainly not the Constitution. The constitutional language hasn't been amended. What's changed, obviously, is the ability of judges, throughout the country, really, to hear those arguments, including the justices of the Supreme Court. And we were convinced from day one that the best way to do that was to tell the story of Edie and Thea, that not only did we have to make the best legal arguments we could, but we had to change minds. And the way to change minds was to persuade the American people, the media, and ultimately the justices, that the marriage that Edie and Thea had, the 44-year marriage, truly in sickness and in health, till death did they part, was the kind of marriage any of us. Who wouldn't be lucky to have a spouse like Edie Windsor? No one knows whether they'll get MS someday, God forbid. But I think we all do know that if, God forbid, that happens, you want to have a spouse like Edie Windsor by your side. And so that was the story we wanted to tell. We told it from day one. We told it in our complaint, which was what the Paul Weiss lawyers call speaking complaint, which tells a story. And we told it in our Supreme Court brief. I mean, it's a very unusual Supreme Court brief. Our merits are red brief. The first 8 pages is the story of their love affair and their marriage. And I think it had a huge impact. There was a movie, fortunately, that had been made, which actually gave Edie the courage to file the case, a documentary, which I highly recommend, called Edie and Thea, A Very Long Engagement, which I think, ironically enough, when Edie decided to file, her view of why her case was going to be so good is because she had a documented marriage. Now think about that. No gay couple today would think they needed anything other than a marriage certificate. But even then, back in 2009, for Edie, the idea that there was a documentary proving that she had a marriage meant that it was the right case to bring, and she was right.
So I want to ask you a little bit about the nature of the Supreme Court. Are cases won in court alone? What I mean by that is the construct of your book really builds the fact that the court is influenced by all the things that have happened. Even your argument when you talk about sea change and other things, even when you began to talk about the blindness and the other things, is really talking about that it is not a pure sense, a matter of the letter of the law, but it is the impact of the law in its day, in its case, and its time. And that is a different view and a different court than we've seen in the past, I think.
Well, I mean,
humbly said,
yeah,
the judge is shaking your head.
I mean, the answer is, I think the way I would answer is that many, many cases, I think, are decided solely in court. Cases of statutory construction, commercial cases, they can be decided very easily, I think, or maybe not so easily, but they're decided on the briefs and the arguments made and the statutory text, et cetera. The law in this case is not that complicated. It's based on a phrase in the Fifth Amendment. It's actually not in the Fifth Amendment. It's in the 14th Amendment. It has been interpreted as being kind of glommed into the Fifth Amendment, that everyone's entitled to equal protection of the laws. That's the case. And the question is, what do those words mean? Words that were drafted after the Civil War to deal with the legacy of slavery. What do those words mean today? Do they apply only to the freed slaves back then, or do they apply to a changed understanding of society? And that's essentially the central debate in constitutional interpretation, a debate that was very much kind of motivated by Justice Scalia, who had a theory of originalism that you interpret the Constitution based on what either the drafters in the 18th century or the people who drafted the 14th Amendment believed. Obviously, if that had been the predominant view, we would not have won this case. But we were very convinced that, you know, let me put it to you this way. So there's a very famous story about the Lawrence case. Lawrence case was argued and won in 2003, exactly 10 years before Windsor. And the story that is told is that most of the bar section, which is where the Supreme Court admitted lawyers sit, at the Supreme Court that day was taken up by Supreme Court clerks, former Supreme Court clerks, who happened to be gay. And when you're in the court and they announce the judges, and there's a huge curtain, I'm sure you've all seen it, that opens and they come out. And the story that I've heard, and Pam Carlin was there, so she's a witness to this, says that in particular when Justice O'Connor came out, you could kind of see her looking around and be like, oh my God, like I didn't know he was gay. Oh my God, I didn't know that she was gay. Oh my God, you know. And this realization, and I don't want to be cute about this because there's something very fundamental. This realization that these people who they knew and worked with and liked and loved were gay. And that's what's changed, frankly. That's what changed between 1996 and 2013. By the time I argued the case, there was no big, they all had gay clerks or knew of gay clerks or had gay friends or family members. There was a big article about the chief, which gave me all kinds of grief, having a cousin who was attending the arguments, who was a lesbian, I think from California. And it's that knowing someone and knowing that they have the same life and the same dignity as you that I think changed the case.
So when I ask you a question that's a little bit different, and there's two parts to this. The world that we live in is a very different world than the world that you and I grew up in. As a rabbi, I have young people coming to me who question the fact of whether they can go through a bar bat mitzvah, or come to me and say, I don't want to keep my bar mitzvah. And I think it's because the kid doesn't want to learn Hebrew, almost, you know, 10 and a half years old. And, you know, you think all the obvious things, and they say, no, the problem is I'm not sure I should have a bar or a bat mitzvah. We live in a world where the expanded issues of identity and gender are profound, and we're ill-equipped in religious life and societal life and all these. Look at all the difficulties and craziness that's going on about bathrooms.
North Carolina. Right?
And when we talk about equal protection under the law, I mean, come on. So these are profound issues, and we're in. How do you see, because I can't imagine that this book, I imagine writing this book was very therapeutic in some ways about going through
that. That's one way to put it.
I told you beforehand, I think this is a book that I want to give to this person that came to me, because I think your sensitivity and your honesty and your openness and being true to yourself is so incredibly, makes me proud as a Jew and proud as a human being that you have that type of courage and you can exhibit that. What are the types of things that, how therapeutic was this, and what are the things that we need to do societally to push forward so that the dignity that's addressed here has a chance of filtering itself into the lives that we live. In 20 words.
Yeah, I was going to say that. I don't know if I'm qualified to answer that question.
I think you're more than qualified.
I think
you showed us a pathway, and we're incredibly proud. Any of us have read this book of what you've done, and you should be incredibly proud because you've opened a door, you've let light in where there was only darkness before.
You know, I think what I would say, I mean, I kind of hinted at this before. I mean, in a lot of ways, for me, kind of growing up and in terms of being a late bloomer in terms of coming out, I think, frankly, think a lot of it had to do with being Jewish. because I grew up in this incredibly warm Jewish community. It was very important to me. I wanted to have kind of the attachment to the community that my family and my grandmother had. And back then, you know, in the late 80s and early 90s, again, kind of with AIDS kind of going up in terms of spreading and in terms of numbers, it didn't seem possible. And I think I would have come out much earlier and frankly had a better time and been more comfortable younger if I had felt that it was a way to do that and be kind of a fully functioning member of the Jewish community. So I think what that means, and I think we're getting there. I think having the conservative movement move the way they have is a huge step. I'm hearing, you know, I live in New York, there are a lot of modern Orthodox Jews in New York, and I'm hearing that at least among modern Orthodox Jews, this is becoming more and more of a non-issue, that the young kids just can't understand why their parents are hung up on it, and that's a good thing as well. But, you know, we're a religion and tradition that talks about, that's based on being an outsider, and that treating outsiders the way we would want to be treated, and we need to keep working on that. And understanding that everyone, there really aren't any insiders, and there's really no one in our community who's an outsider, and that everyone has to feel that they're part of it.
Yes.
First of all, I look forward to reading this book and listening to you. I want to thank you for an incredible presentation. The details leading up to the case itself were just really inspiring to hear, and gave certainly, I think, each of us a greater understanding of the case, and your presentation putting us right there in the Supreme Court was just so beautifully done.
Thank you. It's a lot less stressful doing it today than it was then. Sorry. I said I'm a lot less stressed doing it today than I was then.
I'm sure. But the presentation is just remarkable that you give us all of that background in such wonderful detail, making us feel for each of the participants in this case, and then bringing us to the Supreme Court. By the way, who were the dissenting justices in this case?
Well, that's the incredible thing. So it was a 5-4, just like Obergefell's, a 5-4 case.
Wow.
So Kennedy was the deciding vote.
He was.
Yeah, so it was Kennedy and Kagan and Breyer and Ginsburg and Sotomayor on one side, and Alito, Scalia, Thomas, and the chief on the other.
And the chief.
And that was pretty much, you know, there was kind of speculation after Windsor that maybe they'd get another vote in Obergefell. I didn't think that was a possibility, and it turns out it was.
So you were really right in targeting the language of Kennedy.
Yeah, but that's not my idea. I mean, anyone who practices the Supreme Court, you know, people write their briefs, they're like love, they used to be love letters to Justice Kennedy.
Yeah.
I mean, that was really the strategy in the cases.
Would you tell us a little bit of your thoughts on the possible nominee?
My only thoughts are that I hope very much that he gets confirmed. He's one of the most qualified nominees ever, if not the most in our nation's history, and I hope very much that he's, for the sake of the country, including another 4-4 decision today, which is not good, that he should be confirmed.
So you become sort of a standard bearer for the issue and the cause, and so is this going forward your practice? Have you assumed the mantle of leadership in this?
I don't think so. Yeah, I'm doing other things. I mean, I still have a commercial practice. I represent companies like Airbnb. I represent Columbia University in the Mattress Girl case. So I have a fully active commercial practice. I do continue to do this work. I filed a case after the Supreme Court denied cert in cases that were coming up through the 7th, the 4th, I think in the 10th circuits. I got a call from some women I had met in the South saying, do you want to bring a case in Mississippi? And while I think I would have given the answer, my answer would have been no before those cert denials. After the cert denials, I felt like it was time. And we brought a marriage case in Mississippi. We got assigned to the second only African-American judge ever in the state of Mississippi, a guy by the name of Carlton Reeves. It was probably the most incredible oral argument of my life. I'll give you one example of why it was so amazing. I was doing the argument, and at one point, Judge Reeves interrupted me, and he said, Ms. Kaplan, He said, what do you think about this case? It's known as Brown 2, which is the case after Brown v. Board, where the court was talking about how to implement desegregation in the South, and it said it should be done with all deliberate speed, which in reality meant not so fast. And he said, Ms. Kaplan, what do you think about that? And I thought he was asking the question the way most judges ask the question, which is, you know, what will happen? You know, what is this going to be a real mess? We're in Mississippi, for God's sake. What will happen if I rule your way? And I said, look, Judge, I said, you don't need to worry about that. I said, you know, whether the Supreme Court was wrong or right in Brown 2, you know, for God's sake, you know, people are getting married in Utah, gay couples, and it's no big deal. So there's not going to be rioting on the streets, even in Mississippi. It'll be fine. And he looked at me and he said, Ms. Kaplan, you misunderstand my question. He said, I grew up in the Delta, and I was in first grade in 1974, and it was the first ever integrated class in my hometown. And he said, as far as I'm concerned, Ms. Kaplan, 20 years is too long. I don't know if I will ever have an experience like that again in a courtroom. It was incredible. He wrote a decision. I mean, our briefs, there was like a 20-page limit on our briefs. He wrote an 80-page decision, which is really kind of an incredible chronicle of African-American civil rights, gay civil rights, the combination, the disjunction between the two. It's beautiful decision. After, I think, a decision by Judge Posner in this area and a couple others, it's at the very top, in my view, of the marriage decisions. And so that was an incredible experience. And then after we won in Obergefell, I got a call saying, Mississippi still has a statute on the books that said gay couples can adopt. So I have a case that's currently pending right now in Jackson seeking to hold that statute unconstitutional.
So I want to remind you, and as we thank you, a famous Talmudic discussion goes on. It's coming up. It could be about a steak oven, whether you can, whether it's kosher or Pesach or not. And they have all sorts of arguments between all the things. And one rabbi invokes this, and they do it, and it comes up that there's finally what's called a bat kol, and the voice of God comes down to adjudicate. And the end of the argument is what I think is what you've proven in your passion. It's the same thing we read on Yom Kippur. It says, Lo Aver Liam is not across the sea. Lo Shemayani is not in the heavens. Eilat Picha Ubelevcha, rather in your mouth and in your heart. That law and the decisions that are going to be made do not reside in the heavens nor across the sea. They only remain in our mouths and, more importantly, in our hearts. Your book is all about what is in our hearts and what should be in our hearts. I want to thank you for your presentation, but more for your incredible courage to defend and to pay, they say, mitzvah gevurah, mitzvah us. You laid on the couch of a lady who helped you. And 18 years later, you came back and you repaid that in a way not only to her memory, but to thousands and generations to come. And we thank you for your courage and especially for this presentation. And we'll go outside.